Baha'is believe in progress, and they believe that it should be applied to our lives. The big problem is applying it in a positive and fundamentally useful way. And as I said in my little talk, if you want to not accept a life that's positive, you can, but on the other hand, if you do, as Baha'is do, it's so much greater for your whole life, and you have something that is very fundamentally worthwhile and makes your life different than. And June and I wanted to become healers, so that's what we did. David helped. David knows a lot about this because he helped run the company that manufactured our devices and so on. But I think the Baha'i religion is the religion for the future because it believes in the future and development in the future.
You know, Kat, I've told you before how much I love you.
Yes, that's it.
And how much I admire you. There are a lot of people who accomplish wonderful things. But some of them do so by sacrificing their family. And you never did that. And as I told you when you declared, I think you're such a remarkable person. Uh-huh. It's a rare individual who can find it in their heart to change, to grow. It's really a testament to the eternal soul. I think so many people, when they get to a certain point in life, you're 87, they say to themselves, well, I know who I am. I know what I believe. This is me. But you're still growing. And I think that's fabulous.
Well, got one big supporter.
A whole bunch of them. The whole room.
Well, it's been an interesting life that I've had, and so I decided to put it down in a book that I just finished about, well, it came out 2 or 3 weeks ago. And we have a few of them here if you want, and if more of you want them, that we only have about 6 of them, but if more people want them, I'll be bringing some more of them at the next at the next
It's called The Struggles of Medical Innovation. Mm-hmm. And when he discovered this process, he was not really readily accepted by the people who were in this field. He too was discriminated and was criticized by the judge. But I think that it's a wonderful, wonderful book to read. And so for those of you who are not able to get one tonight, you may wish to order it from this lovely thing that has been sent.
On the cover is a picture of me with called the operating microscope. This is a very wonderful device, which, interestingly enough, is a vine. It was binocular, so it has 3D. And the surgeon can look through the cone of light. So if it's lit in the operating area, you can see it. And it's very, very important from that standpoint. It was developed primarily, interesting enough, to examine the cervix for in situ cancer. Mm-hmm. But I haven't used it for that. But it has a tube on it, which is so that others can, students can watch what the surgeon is doing. When it first came out, they had a viewer tube on it that was upside down and backwards, and whoever was looking through the viewer tube was a surgeon. Couldn't figure out what we were doing because it was all different. So Jack Urban, the one you saw in this picture, developed this viewer tube, which revolutionized training in otology, hearing. And it allowed me to have many, many students that could learn from me. As I was operating, they could watch what I was doing and learn those procedures. And then we had courses, and we had laboratories where we collected this part of the skull just behind the ears called the temporal bone. And we took those out of cadavers, and they can operate on the temporal bones and learn the procedures in the laboratory that way.
Forgive me for telling your story, Pat, but it actually was my father who wanted to develop that tube, because he realized, as he just said, he was always a teacher. And whenever he developed new procedures, new surgeries, new ideas, new thoughts, new devices, he would always tell everybody and teach. And he knew that in his microscope, if he was going to teach people, show people what he was doing, they would have to see it in the correct orientation. So he opened up the telephone book, because he knew he needed to find an engineer who could help him do this. He's not an optical engineer. And kind of went down eeny, meeny, miny, moe, and went to these people and said, as a young doctor, you know, can you help me do this? And he, no, 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 no. Finally, he encountered Jack Urban. He's a U, right? So you know he went to an engineer.
Oh, yes.
And he said to Jack, can you do this? And Jack said, oh, sure. Mm-hmm. Now, Jack knew at the time that it was going to be very expensive and extraordinarily difficult. And he also knew that my father wasn't going to pay him very much. But he liked what the man stood for and what he was doing and trying to do.
58? About 50, yeah. Before that, it would be about, no, I think it would have been about 55, 56.
Wow.
Where did you get the electronics knowledge that you needed for all that?
What's that?
The electronics? Did you ever become an expert in electronics as well?
Urban was the engineer on that, and he could develop. I would say, well, let's try this, and he would build up the device to try it, and we'd try it. Usually in a matter of a couple hours with the patient, we knew it wasn't going to work. And gradually, over a period of 2 years of working like that, we got closer and closer to something that was meaningful. But I remember when I would go to these engineers, because Hollywood is, I'm living in Southern California, Hollywood is full of optical engineers because of the movie industry. And they would always, when I take the microscope in and ask them to take it, help me with it, they say, well, how many can you sell? I say, well, maybe 40, 50, because I figured maybe there were that many training centers. But actually, now thousands and thousands of those viewer tubes and training. Every operating room has microscopes, and they have TV that you can film through it. So it revolutionized training.
Jack Urban eventually established a company to produce microscopes and this ancillary equipment, including cameras and so on and so forth. And after his passing, his son-in-law, to whom he'd given the company, sold it for many millions of dollars.
Well, that's a kind of an interesting story. Alan had a problem that is treated by a few doctors, otologists, called Meniere's disease. You may have heard that term.
Yeah.
What it is patients develop a fullness and pressure in their ear. The ear begins to ring, and then all of a sudden everything starts to spin, and they either fall down or, you know, it's a terrible disease. And it can come on usually with some kind of warning, but as it progresses, it comes on suddenly. And at that point, it's very debilitating for the patient because they're afraid to pick up a baby, for example, or to go to a store because they might fall and knock over all the cans in the room, and they don't want to get on the freeway, and so on. So it's a very debilitating disease. I looked up all of the pathology of it and so on, and found that basically what it was the two kinds of fluids in the inner ear. One of those fluids increases and it causes these symptoms. So if we could drain off that fluid, we could probably cure the disease, and that's what we developed. It was called a shunt, because we shunted the fluid from the inner ear into the fluids around the brain called the spinal fluid.
Mind you, when he says we, he means I.
Yeah, that's right. So anyhow, Alan Shepard, as you well know, was one of the original seven astronauts, and they put him through all kinds of tests and studied them for a couple of months before they selected the final seven as being people who had the ability to work under extreme stress. That was the whole point. Well, at the time, originally when I was in practice, Meniere's disease was considered to be psychosomatic. Ever heard that word? Brain, body.
Yeah.
And so what would happen is that the patient would come in to the doctor, and the doctor would, because the patient was upset, you know, very tense, and looked like they were very nervous and so on, and the doctor ultimately would say, well, how are things at home? And then the family would decide, well, here I've got a loser on our hands, it's somebody that has psychosomatic disease. Well, Alan Shepard was certified as being somebody who could not have psychosomatic disease. And so, to me, it was a very profound thing that we should not treat this as psychosomatic disease. So anyhow, I developed an operation to shunt the fluids and control the disease. So.
But you weren't sure. You weren't sure that it would work.
Well, it wasn't sure, but I estimated that it would work probably 70-80% of patients would get cured. So Alan came out and I operated on him, did the shunt procedure, and after a year, I spun him around and did all kinds of tests to see if he would be suitable for going back into the astronaut program. Because he was head of the astronaut, the astronaut group. But anyhow, after a year, they decided that he could go back to flying. So he invited June and I down to the blast off, Apollo 14. We watched the blast off, and then we went back to Houston to watch the flight from the mission control. And that was very interesting, you know, computers everywhere and all kinds of stuff. And so one night, the astronaut doctor called me and said, would you like to talk to Alan on the way to the moon? I said, sure. So June and I went in, and Alan said, how are you doing, Doc? And I said, I'm doing fine. How are you guys? Well, I'm listening to you on the ear you operated. So that was pretty good. And then afterward, I remember June saying, my God, wait till you get that phone bill. So that's where we decided that Meniere's is not psychosomatic. I think a lot of things that used to be called psychosomatic are no longer that. Terrible diagnosis to me. Oh.